We're reading Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 3, Chapter 29, Explanation of Devotional Service, Text Number 22. Yomam Sarveshu Bhuteshu,
Yomam Sarveshu Bhuteshu,
Shantam Atmanam Ishwaram,
Shantam Atmanam Ishwaram.
Hidvarecham bhajate mudyat,
Hidvarecham bhajate mudyat,
Basmanyeva jyoti sa,
Basmanyeva jyoti sa,
Yomam sarveshu bhuteshu,
Yomam sarveshu bhuteshu,
Shantam atmanam ishwaram,
Shantam atmanam ishwaram,
Vacham bhajate mudyat,
Hidvacham bhajate mudyat,
Basmanyeva jyoti sa,
Basmanyeva jyoti sa,
Yomam sarveshu bhuteshu,
Yomam sarveshu bhuteshu,
Shantam atmanam ishwaram,
Shantam atmanam ishwaram,
Hidvacham bhajate mudyat,
Basmanyeva jyoti sa,
Basmanyeva jyoti sa, Yomam sarveshu bhuteshu,
Yomam sarveshu bhuteshu,
Santam atmanam ishwaram,
Santam atmanam ishwaram,
mam sarveshu bhuteshu.
Yo mam sarveshu bhuteshu.
Santam atmanam ishvaram.
Santam atmanam ishvaram.
Hitva chambhajate maudyat.
Hitva chambhajate maudyat.
Bhasmani eva juhoti saha.
Bhasmani eva juhoti saha. Yo mam sarveshu bhuteshu.
Yo mam sarveshu bhuteshu.
Santam atmanam ishvaram.
Santam atmanam ishvaram.
Hitvacham bhajate maudyat.
Hitvacham bhajate maudyat.
Bhasmani vahi juhati sa.
Bhasmani vahi juhati sa.
Santam atmanam ishvaram.
Santam atmanam ishvaram.
Yo mam sarveshu bhuteshu.
Yo mam sarveshu bhuteshu.
Santam atmanam ishvaram.
Santam atmanam ishvaram.
Hitvarcham bhajate maudyat.
Hitvacham bhajate maudyat.
Bhasmane eva juhoti sa.
Bhasmane eva juhoti sa.
Ya,
ya.
One who.
Mam.
Me. Sarveshu.
Sarveshu.
In all.
Bhuteshu.
Bhuteshu. Living entities.
Shantam.
Being present.
Atmanam.
The Paramatma.
Ishwaram.
The Supreme Lord. Edva.
Disregarding.
Arvam.
The deity.
Bhajate.
Worships.
Modyat.
Because of ignorance.
Bhasmani. Into ashes. Eva. Only. Jahoti.
Offers oblations.
Sa.
He.
Translation. One who worships a deity of Godhead in the temples, but does not know that the Supreme Lord, as Paramatma, is situated in every living entity's heart, must be in ignorance and is compared to one who offers oblations into ashes. Okay, you can repeat. One who worships a deity. In the temple, but does not know that the Supreme Lord as Paramatma is situated in every living entity's heart. Must be in ignorance. And is compared
to one who offers oblations into ashes.
Purport by Srila Prabhupada. It is stated clearly herein that the Supreme Personality of Godhead, in his plenary expansion of Supersoul, is present in all living entities. The living entities have 8,400,000 different kinds of bodies, and the Supreme Personality of Godhead is living in every body, both as the individual soul and as the Supersoul. Since the individual soul is part and parcel of the Supreme Lord, in that sense, the Lord is living in every body. And as super soul, the Lord is also present as a witness. In both cases, the presence of God in every living entity is essential. Therefore, persons who profess to belong to some religious sect but who do not feel the presence of the Supreme Personality of Godhead in every living entity and everywhere else are in the mode of ignorance. If without this preliminary knowledge of the Lord's omnipresence, one simply attaches oneself to the rituals in a temple, church, or mosque, It is as if he were offering butter into ashes rather than into the fire. One offers sacrifice by pouring clarified butter into a fire and chanting Vedic mantras. But even if there are Vedic mantras and all conditions are favorable, if the clarified butter is poured on ashes, then such a sacrifice will be useless. In other words, a devotee should not ignore any living entity. The devotee must know that in every living entity, however insignificant he may be, even in an ant, God is present, and therefore every living entity should be kindly treated and should not be subjected to any violence. In modern and civilized society, slaughterhouses are regularly maintained and supported by a certain type of religious principle. But without knowledge of the presence of God in every living entity, any so-called advancement of human civilization, either spiritual or material, is to be understood as being in the mode of ignorance.
Om ajnana temerandasya jananjana shalakaya chakshur miridam yena tasmai shri gurave namah vancha kaupararubhyesha kripa sindhu vayevacha patitanam pavanibhyo vaishnavibhyo namah. Jai Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhara Shrivasadi Gaura Bhaktavinda. Hare Krishna, Hare Krishna, Krishna Krishna, Hare Hare, Hare Rama, Hare Rama, Rama Rama, Hare Hare.
So Lord Kapila is instructing his mother Devahuti about the process of devotional service.
ลูกชาย Kapildev กำลังตัดให้แม่ดูที
Particularly he wants her to understand that the Lord is present in every living entity.
อยากเข้าใจว่าพระองค์อยู่ในทุกคนทุกแห่ง
Now sometimes in Christianity they will say God, oh no, God is only in the people, it's not in the animals.
ศาสนาคริสต์บอกว่าพระองค์อยู่ในคนแต่ว่าไม่ได้อยู่ในสัตว์
They think the animals are just there for eating. And if there is a soul, they say the soul in the humans is different from the animals. There's animal soul and there are plant souls, different from the human souls. But the Vedic philosophy does not teach like that. The Vedas teach us that there's only one type of soul, and that soul is present in the heart of all living entities. So within everybody, actually, there is the Jivatma, the individual living entity, which is a part of the Supreme Lord. Krishna says in Bhagavad Gita, Mami Vamsa Jiva Loke Jiva Bhuta Sanatana, that the living entities are eternally part and parcel, the Lord.
ทุกคนเป็นร่างอนุของคริสต์นาของพระองค์แล้วก็หัวใจมีอนุแล้วก็มีอภิวิญญาณด้วย
And then there's also the Supreme Lord in his expansion as the super soul in the heart of all living entity. This is confirmed in Bhagavad Gita, Sarvasya Chaham Bridhi Sanivisto, Matapsmi Kirjanam Aponam. Krishna is saying, I am in the heart of everyone. From me comes knowledge, remembrance, and forgetfulness. So Srila Prabhupada is explaining to us that we have to see God in everything, even in the tiny insect. And we should not be violent to other living entities. We shouldn't cut the trees, killing the trees is violence. Killing all the mosquitoes and bed bugs, that's also violence. One devotee, there was some problem with rats at the temple. The devotee was saying to Prabhupada, I can kill them, I'll put some rat poison. Prabhupada said, you should be killed. Because the rats come, because we're not clean, because we don't keep things clean, we don't put things away, we leave garbage lying around, we leave food for the rats, so they come. So we have to see God in all different creatures. So if you just simply, you may be thinking, I'm very pious, I'm a religious person, go to the temple, worship the deity. But if at the same time we're killing the animals and insects, then we're in the mode of ignorance. We will not get any benefit from worshipping the deity. So, Lord Kapila is making the point, we have to understand what we're doing when we worship the deity. We shouldn't just mechanically go and worship the deity. We have to have some proper knowledge about what we're doing. Who is the deity? The deity is Krishna, the Supreme Lord. And he is present in different features. He is present as the Brahman, he is as the Paramatma, and he is also as Bhagavan. Yeah, but anti tat tat vam vidam tat vam yajnanam advayam brahmati paramatmati bhagavaniti sabyate Learned transcendentalists who know the absolute truth call this non-dual substance Brahman, Paramatma, and Bhagavan.
Brahman Viva Sang Sang Mata Atitami, Lava Sang, Lava Me, Paramatma, Paramatma Viva Apimimia, Lava Me Bhagavan, Me Sam, Samrada Kam Bhagavan. Brahman Sang, Lava Paramatma, Apimimia Bhagavan.
So in this way, devotee sees the Lord everywhere, in everything.
Sao Jahin, Tong, Tupo, Yukhan.
And so he should be. Should never be violent to other creatures. We're told about the Christian saint. He was called the flower, his sister flower, and his brother tree. Prabhupada was in Australia, and they arranged for Prabhupada to go and visit this one monastery where all these Christian monks were staying. So Prabhupada was speaking about how the Lord is in everyone's heart. And in God consciousness, Krishna consciousness, we should see Krishna in everyone. And so then the monks were telling them about this Christian saint who was talking to the trees and the flowers like they were brothers and sisters. And Prabhupada said, oh, this is real God consciousness. So, Krishna, God consciousness is not just only in the temple that we worship, only see God only in the deity. That is the very lowest level of God consciousness. But God is not only in the temple, He is everywhere in everything. And we have to recognize the presence of the Lord everywhere. Of course, this confusing what people wonder. Well, how is it possible that people can be so evil? Come on. Not good. Not very good. We're saying they're evil.
What is evil? I think demon is
Gopal, you know what? Your time. Forget all your time.
I think man is demon, I don't know.
Asur.
Asur is man, right?
Evil and man.
Evil, like, evil also man.
Okay. So... So evil, why is there evil? God is in the heart of the sinful, the bad people. He's in their heart, but they don't listen to Him.
ทำไมเขาถึงปฏิบัติไม่ดีแต่ว่าในตัวเขามีมีคริสต์จิตมีดวงวิญญาณของคริสต์อยู่แต่ว่าทำไมเขาถึงปฏิบัติไม่ดี
my farm.
Right. There's a story about the man was in the barber shop, right? And the barber was talking to him about God, and the man was saying, "No, I don't believe there is God."
He said,
if there is God, then why is there so much suffering? Why are people evil? Why are people bad? And so the barber said, "No, it's just like if you go in the street, you see some people, they have long hair and a big beard." So people may say, "Well, I don't believe there's a barber." Because there was a barber, why would he have long hair and a beard? But of course, if they never go to see the barber, they
no long hair.
So in the same way, people, if they never go to see God, if they never go to the temple to see the Lord and to hear about His teachings, so because they never go to see God, so then they think they can do anything they want, anything they like. They do all bad things.
So
in this way, people who may think, they may think they're very good, very pious, but their vision is very narrow,
they cannot see the truth.
So people who worship the deity, they should be Brahman, they should be Brahmins, they should have understood the Brahman, the spirit is there in everyone. And that form of the deity is the form that is the supreme Brahman. We are all tiny parts of the Brahman. And Krishna is the supreme Brahman. And we are all the parts and parcels of Krishna. And we have to take care of all the parts and parcels. Just like in the body, there are many parts. You have to take care of all the parts. If you neglect some part of the body, if you don't take care of it, then it will give you a lot of trouble.
ไม่ดูแล
ไม่ดูแล Or if you have a car, and you don't take care of all the parts of the car, then you get problem. Yeah, if one of the tires goes flat or gets a puncture, you think, oh, it's okay, we've still got three more, the three other ones. Then you can't run the car on three tires, you have to have four wheels. So you have to take care of, in the same way, take care of all the different parts and parcels of Krishna. We have to think how to give Krishna consciousness to all the insects. We don't just simply kill them. This is what, of course, this is what a lot of people, you know, they might be quite religious in the sense, materially religious. They belong to a church, or they're a member of a particular organization, spiritual organization. But at the same time, they're killing, they kill all kinds of creatures and they eat everything. When they're saying, yeah, I love God and Jesus loves you, Jesus loves me. But at the same time, they kill all the other living entities. So this is being condemned here in Srimad
Bhagavatam.
Okay, any questions? Comments?
Srila Prabhupada also says that non-violence is like putting others into distress, right?
Yeah.
So that means we. What kind of distress is that?
If we do things which put people into distress, it's not difficult to understand, really. I mean, what things put people into distress? If you cause them unnecessary pain and hardship, then that is distress. If you don't treat people in an honest and a fair way, then you may cause them some distress, some difficulties. So this is violence. We don't recognize Krishna in the heart of everyone and think how to give them Krishna consciousness, then this is also violence. Prabhupada was asked to speak at a conference. They were releasing a book about Mahatma Gandhi, and it was Mahatma Gandhi, of course, he was always teaching ahimsa, non-violence. So Prabhupada explained the real meaning of non-violence. If you're actually going to practice ahimsa, non-violence, then you have to recognize that everyone is a spiritual entity and benefit them by giving them Krishna consciousness. Anything which stops a person from becoming Krishna conscious is violence. If you restrict the person from practicing, if you don't give people Krishna consciousness, then this is all violence. You just encourage them in sense gratification, that's also violence. So ahimsa is a good, it's an important quality, it's a good quality. It's not the highest principle of religion, of course. Just like Lord Buddha taught ahimsa. But that is not the highest principle of religion. That is one of the sub-religious principles. We have to understand what is the real purpose of religion. And that is to develop Krishna prema, love for God. So ahimsa, violence is denying people the opportunity to become God conscious. If we don't tell people about Krishna, then we're denying them the opportunity to become God conscious. We know the solution, we know the solution to the problem. The solution is God consciousness, Krishna consciousness. And if we don't tell people, then we're violent, we're guilty of violence. So just like if you know the cure for cancer or some other horrible disease, then we would want to tell people. We would tell them how you can cure that disease. So in the same way people have the disease of the material body, they're suffering in the material body. And we know the cure. The cure is Krishna consciousness. They have to hear and they have to chant about Krishna. And that will solve all of their problems. If they hear and chant. They become Krishna conscious, then they'll get free of all that suffering. But if we just let people stay in the material world and take birth again and again, then this is violence. It means we have no compassion, we have no feelings for others. So we should want to distribute. We want to share it. Like sharing our Krishna consciousness. Okay. Yeah?
When you were talking about that, I think the couple of you were explaining on the Paramatma level, right? On the three levels of emotions. Mm-hmm. So Bhagavan, I mean, we were talking about deity worship. I find it very difficult because, I mean, deity worship also needs a very high standard, right, Ma? I mean, so we also, you know, it's mentioned that those who are, you know, just actually doing the deity worship may not be in Kanishtha level, but if they see only deity, you know, Krishna and the deities, they are in the Kanishtha level. Is it like that, Ma?
Yeah. Well, there are different levels. Not everybody, they may be doing deity worship, it doesn't mean they're on the highest level. Deity worship is to help bring us to a higher level, to help us to cultivate our purity, our cleanliness, our regulation. These things all come when we engage in deity worship. Some people may be worshipping the deity, though they may be like they're described here. They may be in the mode of ignorance. They only see Krishna in the deity. So there are different levels of deity.
deity worship.
And how important it is for the, you know, devotees us practicing to, you know, do the deity worship. I mean, we often hear like Grihasthas and, you know, they should have some deity worship, or, you know,
well, deity worship doesn't just only mean deity, the stat, the form, you know, you can worship pictures also as a deity. The Lord is also there in a picture. So worship, you can worship the photo, that's also deity worship. Yeah, some kind of worship you should do. You may have deities, you may have shaligrams, you may whatever. It's all good. Everything depends on the attitude. We know in the Nectar of Devotion there's a story about the Brahmana. He didn't have any deities, but in his mind he was worshipping the deity. So important thing is, you know, that we use our mind for the service of Krishna. You have a deity, you have a Krishna, we should think the picture, Gornitaya there in the picture. So every day we offer arti to them, we do kirtan, we offer food. Yeah, deity worship. Have to, from time to time, you have to offer arti. You should know how to do it. You should know how to do deity worship. So for some time, you can learn. Just like we go in the kitchen, that's also part of deity worship, cooking for the deity. And we should think of it also like that. When we go in the kitchen, you're not just going in the kitchen to cook for people, you're cooking for Krishna. And we should think like that, you're cooking for the Lord. That's also deity worship. You take the course in deity worship in Mayapur. They take they go to the kitchen, and all the devotees learn cooking and how to, what should be the standard in the kitchen. Not only just on the altar, the kitchen also. Yeah.
Maharaj, how should we retreat or make people understand the Bible? Usually my friends come up to me and say, although you're vegetarian, you're still killing plants which are souls. Because they won't understand the context of Patram Pushpam Palam Kulam. So how should we make them understand?
They are vegetarian?
No.
They're not vegetarian. Well, there are many advantages to being a vegetarian. You can explain to them about the nature of the body, the anatomy of the body. The teeth, for example, are designed in a way they're more for chewing than for tearing. When you eat meat, you tear the meat. Meat-eating animals like the dog, they have sharp teeth for tearing. They don't chew. But the human body, we have flat teeth. The teeth are meant for chewing and grinding. And that's what we do when we eat grains and vegetables. So the teeth are one thing, the design of the intestines, that we have a long intestinal tract, whereas meat-eating animals have a short intestinal tract, so they evacuate quickly, but the human body doesn't evacuate so quickly, it takes longer for the food to pass. So that's why if you eat meat, you want to evacuate it quickly, because there's a lot of poisons in the meat. But the vegetarian diet is convenient for the longer intestine. And the acids also in the intestine. The acids in the human body are not as strong as the acids in a meat-eating animal, like the dog and tiger and so on. They have very high level of acids to dissolve the meat. But the acids in the human body are not so strong. So it's much healthier for people to take a vegetarian diet. So like that, you can explain these things. the nature of the body. You can explain also about how when you raise animals, it takes so much more land and so much food is wasted to feed the animals, to fatten the animals so people can kill the animals and eat them. But if we simply use the land to grow food for ourselves to eat, then it's, we can feed much more people. So scarcity, food scarcity comes about because of people eating too much meat. And also the karmic reactions which you get. The animals have, they feel also pain. If you go to the slaughterhouse and watch the animals being killed, then they won't feel so much like eating flesh anymore. When you have to go and watch the animal, how they suffer, and how cruel the whole business is, then people will think less about eating. But people, because we're so cold-hearted, we just go to McDonald's and go to the KFC and you eat all kinds of things. And we don't think what they're eating. So there are many books and authors who've written about these things. But they say, you are what you eat. So you eat. You make your body like a graveyard when you put dead bodies into it. You, people may say, well, we're killing plants, vegetables, but there's a big difference between plants and animals. Just like people eat animals, we can ask them, do you eat people also? Would you eat people? So most people would say, no, they don't eat people. Why? Because people are different from animals. So in the same way, animals are different from plants. The plants are natural food, which is given by God for us to eat. But the animals are not really meant for us to eat. Animals are also creation of God. They're there for a different purpose. Just like animals, like a cow. Cow provides milk, and the bull can plow the field. So, people need to be educated. They need to have vegetarian societies, you need to propagate, make some propaganda, get people to understand, to think more about what they're eating, what they're putting into their body, what they're doing to their bodies. The whole planet could be a much different place if people were vegetarian, if there was less meat eating. You see that the reactions which come from killing animals, like taking all the animals to the slaughterhouse, because they're killing animals, so they get reactions for them. It's the law of karma. Now, law of karma is there in every culture, in every society, in China and in the Bible and everywhere they talk about these things. The Bible says, as you sow, so shall you reap. And in China also they have the same thing, that if you do good, you will get good. If you do bad, you get bad. If you plant beans, you harvest beans. If you plant melons, you harvest melons. So you get the results of your work. If you're giving pain and suffering to others, you will get pain and suffering also. So also vegetarian diet is to make proper use of the planet, that everything is provided on the planet for us. If we just take what we need, if we're not too greedy. But people are so greedy, they want to eat animals and they will kill them. Why do they like animals? Because they like the taste of blood. Just that is the reason why they're eating meat. They like the taste of blood. So you want to taste blood? Taste the natural way, milk. Milk is the blood of the cow transformed. Drink milk. You don't get karma. You won't get bad karma for that. You'll get good karma. Okay? Srimad Bhagavatam ki jai.